Tanter Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Storm Season, edited by Robert Lynn Asprin and Lynn Abbey, narrated by Jonathan Johns. Introduction. Robert Lynn Asprin. It had been a long time since Hakim, Sanctuary's oldest storyteller, had visited that section of town known only as the Fisherman's Quarters. But he still knew the way. Not much had changed. The stalls with their flimsy awnings to keep the sun off the day's catch, the boats bottom up along the pier, and on the beach, a few nets hung for drying and mending. All was the same, only more faded and worn, like the people, like the rest of the town. Hakim had watched Sanctuaries decline over the years, watched the economy dry up as the citizens became more desperate and vicious. He had watched and chronicled with the detached eye of a professional tailspinner. Sometimes, though, like this, when a prolonged absence made the deterioration more apparent to the eye than the day-to-day erosion of his more favoured haunts, he felt a pang of sorrow not unlike that he felt the day he visited his father and realised the man was dying. He had cut that visit short and never returned, preferring in his then youth to preserve the memories of his sire in the joyful strength of his prime. Hakim had always regretted that decision, and now that the town he had adopted and grown to love was in its death throes, he was determined not to repeat his earlier mistakes by abandoning it. He would stay with Sanctuary, sharing its pain and comforting it with his presence, until either the town or he, or both, died. Having renewed his resolve, the storyteller turned his back on the heartbreaking sight of the docks. Once the pride of Sanctuary, now a ghastly parody of their own memory, and entered the tavern which was his objective. The wine barrel was a favourite haunt of those fishermen who wished to indulge in a bit of socialising before returning to their homes. Today was no exception, and Hakim easily located the person he sought. Omat was sitting alone at a corner table, a full tankard held loosely in his lone hand as he stared thoughtfully into the distance. For a moment, Hakim hesitated, reluctant to intrude on the one-armed fisherman's self-imposed isolation. But then curiosity won out over discretion, and he approached the table. "May I join you, Omat?" The fisherman's eyes came into focus and he blinked with surprise. "Hakim? What brings you to the docks? Has the vulgar unicorn finally run out of wine?" The tailspinner ignored the jibe and sank down onto one of the vacant stools. "I am tracking a story," he explained earnestly. "A rumour which can only be fleshed out to audience-satisfying proportions with your assistance." "A story?" Omat repeated, his gaze suddenly evasive. "Adventures only happen to your rich merchants or shadow-hugging cutthroats, not to us simple fisherfolk, and certainly not to me." "So?" Hakim asked, feigning surprise. "It was some other one-armed fisherman who this very day told the garrison captain about the disappearance of the old man and his son." Omat favoured him with a black glare. "I should know better than to expect secrecy in this town," he hissed. "Bad news draws curiosity seekers like the prince's gallows draw ravens. As they say, you can get anything in Sanctuary but help." "Surely the authorities will investigate," the storyteller asked, though he already knew the answer. "Investigate?" The fisherman spat noisily on the floor. "You know what they told me, these precious authorities of yours. They say the old man must have drowned, he and his son both. They say the old man must have fallen overboard in a sudden squall. Do you believe that? The old man fallen overboard? And him as much a part of his boat as the oarlocks. And Hort, who could swim like the fishes themselves before he could take a step. Drown, both of them, with their boat still afloat." "Their boat was still afloat," Hakim pressed eagerly. Omat eyed him for a moment, then leaned forward to share the tale at last. "For weeks now, the old man has been taking Hort out, teaching him the tricks of deep water boating. Oh, I know Hort'll never be a fisherman. I know it. Hort knew it, and so did the old man. But it was a handy excuse for the old man to show off a bit for his son. And to Hort's credit, he played along.
As patient with the old man as the old man had been with him. It warmed us all to see those two smile on each other again.
The fisherman's own smile was brief as the memories crowded in on him. Then he continued.
Yesterday they went out. Far out, beyond the sight of land or the other boats. I thought at the time that it was dangerous and said as much to Haron. She only laughed and told me not to worry.
The old man was more than a match for the sea at this time of year. The fisherman took a long pull at his drink.
But they didn't return.
I thought perhaps they'd come ashore elsewhere and spent most of the night roaming the other piers asking for them. But no one had seen them. This morning I took my boat out. It took till noon, but I finally spotted the craft, floating free, with its oars shipped. Of the old man in Hort I couldn't find a trace. I towed the boat in and sought out the city garrison to report the disappearance. You already know what they told me. Drowned in a squall. And us still months away from the storm season.
Akeem waited until the fisherman had lapsed into silence before he spoke.
Could it have been some creature from the deep? I don't pretend to know the sea, but even a storyteller hears tales.
Omat regarded him steadily.
Perhaps, he admitted carefully. I wouldn't risk the deep waters here in daylight, much less at night. Gods and monsters are both best left untempted. Yet you risked them today,
the storyteller persisted, cocking his head to one side.
The old man was my friend,
the fisherman answered flatly.
But if it's monsters you want for your stories, then I suggest you seek after the two-legged kind that spend gold. What are you saying, Omat?
Although they were already sitting close, Omat shot a furtive glance about the room to check for eavesdroppers.
Only this, he murmured. I saw a ship out there. A ship that shouldn't have been there. Shouldn't have been anywhere. Smugglers. I've seen smuggler ships before, storyteller,
the fisherman snarled.
We know them and they know us. And we give each other wide berth. If the old man were fool enough to close with the smuggler ship, I'd have found him dead in his boat or floating in the water beside it. What use would the smuggler have for extra bodies? Then who?
The storyteller frowned.
That's the mystery, Omat scowled. The ship was far off, but from what I could make out, it was unlike any ship I've ever seen or heard of. What's more, it wasn't following the coast or making for the smuggler's island. It was putting out straight into the open sea. Did you tell this to the authorities?
Akeem asked.
The authorities, snorted the fisherman. Tell them what? That my friends were stolen away by a ghost ship out of legend that sailed off over the horizon into uncharted waters. They would have thought I was drunk, or worse, added me to the collection of crazies that Kitty Cat's been gathering. I've told them too much as it is, though I've told you even more. Beware, storyteller. I'd not like losing another day's fishing because you put my name to one of your yarns and stirred the curiosity of those do-nothing gods.
Akeem would have liked to inquire further about the ghost ship out of legend, but it was apparent he was on the verge of overstaying his welcome.
I tell no story before I know its end, he assured his glaring host. And what you've told me is barely the beginning of a tale. I'll hold my tongue until I've learned more, and even then I'll give you the first telling for free, in payment for what you've given me now. Very well, Omat grumbled. Though I'd rather you skip the tale and bought a round of drinks instead. A poor man must guard his coinage,
Akeem laughed, rising to go. Then he hesitated.
The old man's wife?
He asked. Omat's eyelids dropped to half-mast, and there was a wall, suddenly, between the two men.
She'll be taken care of. In the fisherman's quarter, we look after our own.
Feeling awkward, the storyteller fished a small pouch of coins from within his robes.
Here, he said, setting it on the table. It isn't much, but I'd like to help with what little I can afford.
The pouch sat untouched.
Shall not take charity from city folks.
For a moment, the diminutive storyteller swelled to twice his normal appearance.
Then you give it to her, he hissed. Or give it to those who are supporting her, or rub it in a fish barrel until it reeks.
He caught himself. Suddenly aware of the curious stares from the neighboring tables. In a flash, the humble storyteller had returned.
Omat, my friend, he said quietly. You know me. I am no more of this city than I am a fisherman or a soldier. Don't let an old woman's pride stand between her and a few honest coppers. They'll spend as well as any other when pushed across the board of a fish stall. Slowly the fisherman picked up the pouch, then locked eyes with Akeem.
Why?
The storyteller shrugged. The tale of the old man and the giant crab has paid me well. I would not like the taste of wine bought with that money while this woman was without.
Omat nodded and the purse disappeared from view. It was dusk when Akeem emerged from the wine barrel. Lengthening shadows hid the decay he had noticed earlier, though it was also true that his outlook had improved after his gift had been accepted. On an impulse, the storyteller decided to walk along the piers before returning to the maze. The rich smells of the ocean filled his nostrils, and a slight breeze snatched at his robes as he digested Omat's story. The disappearance of the old man and his son was but the latest in a series of unusual occurrences. The war brewing to the north, the raid on Jubal's estate, and the disappearance and later reappearance of both Tempus and One Thumb. All were like the rumble of distant thunder, heralding a tempest of monumental proportions. Omat had said the storm season was months off, but not all storms were forged by nature. Something was coming. The storyteller could feel it in the air and see it in the faces of the people on the streets, though he could no more have put a name to it than they could have. For a few moments he debated making one of his rare visits to a temple, but as always the sheer number of deities to be worshipped or appeased daunted him. With petty jealousies rampant among gods and priests, it was better to abstain completely than risk choosing wrong. The same coins he could have given as an offering might also buy a glimpse of the future from a bazaar seer. Of course, their ramblings were often so obscure that one didn't recognize the truth until after it had happened. With a smug grin, Akeem made up his mind. Instead of investing in gods or seers, he would quest for insight and omen in his own way. Staring into a cup of wine, quickening his step, the storyteller set his course for the Vulgar Unicorn.
Exercise in Pain. Robert Lynn Asprin.
There must be trouble. Salaman had been gone far too long for his mission to be going smoothly. Some might have had difficulty judging the passage of time during the period of time between sundown and sunrise, but not Jubal. His early years as a gladiator in the Rankin capital had included many sleepless nights before arena days, or blood days, as those in the trade called them. He knew the darkness intimately. Each phase of the night had its own shade, its own texture, and he knew them all. Even with his eyes blurred with sweat and tears of pain as they were now. Too long. Trouble. The twin thoughts danced in his mind as he tried to focus his concentration to formulate a contingency plan. If he was right, if he was now alone and wounded, what could he do? He couldn't travel far, pulling himself painfully along the ground with his hands. If he encountered one of those who hunted him, or even a random townsperson with an old grudge, he couldn't defend himself. To fight, a man needed legs, working legs. He knew that from the arena too. The oft-repeated words of his arena instructor sprang into his mind, crowding out all other thoughts.
Move! Move, damn you! Retreat! Attack! Retreat! Circle! Move! If you don't move, you're dead! If I don't kill you myself, your next opponent will! Move! A still fighter's a dead fighter. Now move! Move!
A half-heard sound wrenched Jubal's fevered thoughts back to the present. His hand dropped to his dagger hilt as he strained to penetrate the darkness with his erratic vision. Salaman. Perhaps. But in his current state, he couldn't take any chances. As his ally knew his exact location, the information could have been forced out of him by Jubal's enemies. Sitting propped up against a tree with his legs stretched out before him, Jubal cast about looking for new cover. Not 2 paces away was a patch of knee-high weeds. Not much, but enough. The ex-gladiator allowed himself to fall sideways, catching himself on one hand and easing his body the rest of the way to the ground. Then it was reach, pull, reach, pull, slowly making his way towards and finally into the weed patch. Though he used his free hand to maintain his balance, once one of the broken arrow shaft protruding from his knees scraped along the ground, sending a sheet of red agony through his mind. Still, he kept his silence, though he could feel sweat running off his body. Reach, pull, reach. Safely in the weeds now, he allowed himself to rest. His head sank completely to the ground, the dagger slid from its scabbard, and he held it point down, hiding the shine of his blade with his forearm. Trembling from the efforts of his movement, he breathed through his nose to slow and silence his recovery. Inhale, exhale, wait. Two figures appeared, patches of black against deeper black, bracketing the tree against which he had recently lain.
"Well," came a voice loud in the darkness, "where is my patient? I can't treat a ghost."
"He was here, I swear it,"
Jubal smiled, relaxing his grip on the dagger. The second voice was easy to recognize. He had heard it daily for years now.
"You're still no warrior, Salaman,"
he called, propping himself up on one elbow.
"I've said before, you wouldn't recognize an ambush unless you stumbled into it."
His voice was weak and strained to a point where he scarcely recognized it himself. Still, the two figures started violently at the sound, rising from a point near their ankles. Jubal relished their frightened reaction for a moment. Then his features hardened.
"You're late," he accused.
"We would have been quicker,"
his aide explained, hastily.
"But the healer here insisted we pause while he dug up some plants. Some cures are strongest when they are fresh,"
Alton Stolwig announced loftily as he strode toward Jubal.
"And from what I've been told..."
He stopped suddenly, peering at the weeds around his patient.
"Speaking of plants," he stammered, "are you aware that the particular foliage you're laying in exudes an irritating oil that will cause the skin to itch and burn?"
For some inexplicable reason, the irony contained in this recitation of dangers struck Jubal hilarious, and he laughed for the first time since the stepsons had invaded his estate.
"I think, healer," he said at last, "that at the moment I have greater problems to worry about than a skin rash."
Then exhaustion and shock overtook him, and he fainted. It wasn't the darkness of night, but a deeper blackness, the blackness of the void, or of a punishment cell. They came for him out of the black. Unseen enemies with daggers like white hot pokers attacking his knees while he struggled vainly to defend himself. Once, no twice, he had screamed aloud and tried to pull his legs close against his chest, but a great weight held them down while the torturer did his work. Unable to move his hands or arms, Jubal wrenched his head about, drooling and gibbering incoherent, impotent threats. Finally, his mind slipped onto another plane. A darker plane where there was no pain, no feeling at all. Slowly, the world came back into focus. So slowly that Jubal had to fight to distinguish dream from reality. He was in a room. No, in a hovel. There was a guttered candle struggling to give off light, crowded in turn by the sun streaming in through a doorway without a door. He lay on the dirt floor, his clothes damp and clammy from his own sweat. His legs were bound from thigh to calf with bandages, lumpy bandages, as if his legs had no form save for what the rags gave them. Alton Stolwig, Sanctuary's favorite healer, squatted over him, keeping the sun rays from his face.
"You're awake, good," the man grunted. "Maybe now I can finish my treatment and go home. You're only the second black I've worked on, you know. The other died. It's hard to judge skin tone in these cases."
"Salaman,"
Jubal croaked.
"Outside, relieving himself. You underestimate him, you know. Warrior or not, he kept me from following my better judgment. Threatened to carve out my stomach if I didn't wait until you regained consciousness."
"Salaman,"
Jubal laughed weakly.
You've been bluffed, healer. He's never drawn blood. Not all those who work for me are cutthroats.
I believed him, the healer retorted stiffly, and I still do. As well you should, Salaman added from the doorway. In one hand he carried a corroded pan, its handle missing. He carried it carefully, as if it or its contents were fragile. In his other hand he held Jubal's dagger. When he attempted to shift his body and greet his aid, Jubal realized for the first time that his arms were bound over his head, tied to something out of his line of vision. Kneeling beside him, Salaman used the dagger to free Jubal's hands, then offered him the pan, which proved to be half full of water. It was murky, with twigs and grass floating in it, but it did much for removing the fever taste from the slaver's mouth.
I shouldn't expect you to remember, Salaman continued, but I have drawn blood at least 4 times, with 2 sure kills, all while getting you out of the estate.
To save my life.
My life was involved too, Salaman shrugged. The raiders were rather unselective about targets by then. If I might finish my work, Stolwig interrupted testily. It has been a long night, and you two will have much time to talk.
Of course, Jubal agreed, waving Salaman away. How soon before I can use my legs again?
The question hung too long in the air, and Jubal knew the answer before the healer found his voice.
I've removed the arrows from your knees, Stolwig mumbled. But the damage was great, and the infection.
How long?
This time the slaver was not asking, he demanded.
Never.
Jubal's hand moved, smoothly, swiftly past his hip, and then hesitated as he realized it was not holding the dagger. Only then did his conscious mind understand that Salaman had his weapons. He sought to catch his aide's eye, to signal him, before he realized that his ally was desperately avoiding his gaze.
I have applied a poultice to slow the spread of the infection, Alton went on, unaware that he might have been dead, as well as applied the juice of certain plants to deaden your pain, but we must proceed with treatment without delay.
Treatment?
The slaver glared, the edge momentarily gone from his temper.
But you said I wouldn't be able to use my legs.
You speak of your legs,
the healer sighed.
I'm trying to save your life, though I've heard there are those who would pay well to see it ended.
Jubal heard the words and accepted them without the rush of fear other men might feel. Death was an old acquaintance of all gladiators.
Well, what is this treatment you speak of?
He asked levelly.
Fire,
Stolwig stated without hesitation. We must burn the infection out before it spreads further.
No.
But the wounds must be treated, the healer insisted.
You call that a treatment? Jubal challenged. I've seen burned legs before. The muscles replaced by scar tissue. They aren't legs. They're things to be hidden.
Your legs are finished, Stolwig shouted. Stop speaking of them as if they were worth something. The only question worth asking is, do you wish to live or die?
Jubal let his head sink back until his was staring at the hovel ceiling.
Yes, healer, he murmured softly. That is the question. I'll need time to consider the answer.
But
if I were to answer right now,
the slaver continued harshly,
I'd say I'd prefer death to the life your treatment condemns me to. But that's the answer a healthy Jubal would give. Now, when death is real, the true answer requires more thought. I'll contact you with my decision.
Very well,
Alton snarled, rising to his feet. But don't take too long making up your mind. Your black skin makes it difficult to judge the infection, but I'd guess you don't have much time left to make your choice.
How much? Salaman asked.
1 day or 2. After that, we'd have to take the legs off completely to save his life. But by then it might only be a choice of deaths.
Very well, Jubal agreed.
But in case I'm wrong, Stolwig said suddenly, I'd like my payment now.
The slaver's head came up with a jerk, but his aid had forereached him.
Here,
Salaman said, tossing the healer a small pouch of coins.
For your services, and your silence.
Alton hefted the purse with raised eyebrows, nodded, and started for the doorway.
Healer,
Jubal called from the floor, halting the man in mid-stride.
Currently, only the three of us know my whereabouts. If any come hunting us and fail to finish the job, one or both of us will see you suffer hard before you die.
Alton hesitated, then moistened his lips.
And if someone finds you accidentally? Then we'll kill you accidentally,
Salaman concluded. The healer looked from one set of cold eyes to the other, jerked his head in a half-nod of agreement and finally left. For a long time after his departure, silence reigned in the hovel.
Where did you get the money?
Jubal asked, when such thoughts were far from his aide's mind.
What?
The money you gave Stowig,
Jubal clarified.
Don't tell me you had the presence of mind to gather our house funds from their hiding places in the middle of the raid.
Better than that, Salaman said proudly. I took the records of our holdings.
From the early beginnings of Jubal's rise to power in Sanctuary, he had followed Salaman's advice, particularly when it concerned the safety of his wealth. Relatively little of his worth was kept at the estate, but was instead spread secretly through the town as both investments and caches. In a town like Sanctuary, there were many who would gladly supplement their income by holding a package of unknown content for an equally unknown patron. Jubal forced himself up into a sitting position.
That raises a question I've been meaning to ask since the raid. Why did you save me? You placed yourself in physical danger, even killed to get me out alive. Now, it seems, you've got the records of my holdings, most of which you've managed. You could be a wealthy man if I were dead. Why risk it all in an attempt to pluck a wounded man from the midst of his enemies?
Salaman got up and wandered to the doorway. He leaned against the rough wood frame and stared at the sky before he answered.
When we met, when you hired me, you saved me from the slave block by letting me buy my freedom with my promises. You wouldn't have me as a slave, you said, because slaves were untrustworthy. You wanted me as a free man, earning a decent living for services rendered, and with the choice to leave if I felt my fortunes might be better somewhere else.
He turned to face Jubal directly.
I pledged that I would serve you with all my talents, and that if I ever should leave, I would face you first with my reasons for leaving. I said that until then, you need never doubt my intentions or loyalties. You laughed at the time, but I was serious. I promised my mind and life to the person who allowed me to regain my freedom on his trust alone. And the time of the raid, I had not spoken to you about resigning, and while I usually content myself with protecting your interests and leave the protecting of your life to yourself and others, I would have been remiss to my oath if I had not at least tried to rescue you. And as it turned out, I was able to rescue you.
The slaver studied his aide's face. The limbs were softer and the belly fuller than the angry slave's, who had once struggled wildly with the guards while shouting his promises, but the face was as gaunt as it ever had been, and the eyes were still bright with intelligence.
And why was that resignation never offered, Salaman?
Jubal asked softly.
I know you had other offers. I often waited for you to ask me for more money, but you never did. Why?
I was happy where I was. Working for you gave me an unusual blend of security and excitement with little personal risk, at least until quite recently. Once I used to daydream about being an adventurer or a fearless leader of men.
Then I met you and learned what it took to lead that sort of life. I lacked the balance of caution and recklessness, the sheer personal charisma necessary for leadership. I know that now, and am content to do what I do best, risking someone else's money or giving advice to the person who actually has to make the life and death decisions.
A cloud passed over Salaman's expression.
That doesn't mean, however, that I don't share many of your emotions. I helped you build your web of power in Sanctuary. Helped you select and hire the hawk masks who were so casually butchered in the raid. I, too, want revenge, though I know I'm not the one to engineer it. You are, and I'm willing to risk everything to keep you alive until that vengeance is complete.
Alive, like this,
Jubal challenged.
How much charisma does a cripple have? Enough to rally a vengeful army.
Salaman averted his eyes.
If you cannot regain your power, he admitted, I'll find another to follow. But first I'll stay with you until you've reached your decision. If there's anyone who can inspire a force, it's you, even crippled.
Then your advice is to let Stowig do his work.
There seems to be no option, unless you'd rather death.
There is one.
Jubal grinned humorlessly.
Though it's one I am loath to take. I want you to seek out Balustrus, the Metal Master. Tell him our situation and ask. No, beg him to give us shelter.
Balustrus?
Salaman repeated the name as if it tasted bad.
I don't trust him. There are those who'd say he's mad.
He's served us well in the past. Whatever else he's done,
the slaver pointed out.
And more important, he's familiar with the sorceress element in town.
Sorcery?
Salaman was genuinely astounded.
Aye, Jubal nodded grimly. As I said, I have little taste for the option, but it's still an option nonetheless. And perhaps better than death or maiming.
Perhaps, the aide said with a grimace. Very well. I'm off to follow your instructions.
Salaman,
the slaver called him back.
Another instruction. When you speak to Balustrus, don't reveal our hiding place. Tell him I'm somewhere else, in the charnel houses. I trust him no more than you do.
Jubal bolted awake, out of his half-slumber, his dagger once again at the ready. That sound, nearby and drawing closer. Pulling himself along the floor toward the doorway, the slaver wondered, for the first time, just whose hovel Salaman had hid him in. He had assumed it was abandoned, but perhaps the rightful owner was returning. With great care, he poked his head out of the bottom corner of the doorway and beheld goats. A sizable herd meandered toward the hut, but though they caught the ex-gladiator's attention, they did not hold it. Two men walked side by side behind the animals. One was easily recognized as Salaman. The other's head came barely to Salaman's shoulder, and he walked with a rolling, bouncing gait. Jubal's eyes narrowed with suspicion and puzzlement. Whatever Salaman's reason for revealing their hideaway to a goat herder, it had better been a good one. The slaver's mood had not been improved by the time the men reached the doorway. If anything, it had darkened as two goats strayed ahead of the rest of the herd and made his unwilling acquaintance.
Jubal,
Salaman declared, hardly noticing the goats that had already entered the hovel.
I want you to meet
a goat herder,
the slaver spat out.
Have you lost your mind?
Not a goat herder,
the aide stammered, surprised by Jubal's erupting anger.
He's a Lycerine.
I don't care where he was born. Get him and his goat out of here.
Another goat entered and they argued and stood at Jubal's feet, staring down on him with blandly curious eyes, while the rest of the herd explored the corners.
Allow me to explain, my lord,
the little man said quickly and nervously.
It's not where I'm from, but what I am. The Order of Lycerine. A humble order devoted to the study of healing through sorcery.
It can mend your legs,
Salaman blurted out.
Completely. You'll be able to walk or run, if you wish.
Now it was Jubal's turn to blink in astonishment, as he absently shoved one of the goats aside.
You? You're a wizard. You don't look like any of the magicians I've seen in town.
It's a humble order,
the man replied, fussing with his threadbare robe.
And then again, living with the goats does not encourage the finery my town-dwelling colleagues are so proud of.
Then these are your goats.
Jubal shot a dark look at Salaman. I use them in my magic, the Lizarine explained, and they provide me with sustenance. As I said, it...
I know, Jubal repeated. It's a humble order. Just answer one question. Is Salaman right? Can you heal my legs?
Well, I can't say for sure until I've examined the wounds, but I've been successful in many cases.
Enough. Begin your examination. And Salaman, get these damn goats out of the hut.
By the time Salaman had gotten the animals into the yard, the Lizarine had the bandages off and was probing Jabal's legs. It was the first time the slaver had seen the wounds, and his stomach rebelled at the sight of the damage.
Not good. Not good at all, the magician mumbled. Far worse than I was told. See here, the infection, almost halfway up the thigh.
Can you heal them?
Jubal demanded, still not looking at the wounds.
It will be costly, the Lizarine told him, and with no guarantee of complete success.
I knew that before I sent for you, the slaver snarled. Your profession always charges high and never guarantees their work. No sellsword would stay alive if he demanded a sorcerer's terms.
The wizard looked up from his examination. His expression had gone hard. I wasn't speaking of my fee, he corrected his patient, but of the strain to your body and mind. What is more, it is your strength, and not mine, which will determine the extent of your recovery. Strength of muscle and of spirit. If I and others had fallen short in our heels, it is because most arrogant warriors have greater egos than skills, and are also lacking. He caught himself and turned again to the wounds. Forgive me, my lord. Sometimes being of a humble order is wearing on the nerves.
Don't apologize, man, Jubal laughed. For the first time, I begin to have some faith in your ability to do what you promise. What is your name?
Furtan, my lord.
And I am Jubal. Not my lord, the slaver told him. Very well, Furtan. If strength is what's needed, then between the two of us, we should be able to renew my legs.
How much strain to the mind and body? Salaman asked from the doorway. Jubal glared at his aide, annoyed by the interruption, but Furtan had already turned to face Salaman and did not see. A fine question, the Lizarine agreed. To grasp the answer, you must first understand the process. He was in his own element now, and his nervousness melted away. There will be two parts to the healing. The first is relatively simple, but it will take some time. It involves drawing out the infection, the poisons from the wounds. The true test lies in the second phase of the healing. There is damage here, extensive damage, and to the bones themselves. To mend bone takes time. More time that I'd venture, my lord Jubal wishes to invest. I would therefore accelerate the body processes, thereby shortening the time required. While in this state, you will consume and pass food at an incredible rate, for the body needs fuel for the healing. What would normally require days will transpire in hours, the processes of months compacted into weeks.
Have you ever used this technique before? Salaman asked.
Oh yes, Furtan assured him. In fact, you know one of my patients. It was I who healed Balustrus. Of course, that was back in the capital, before he changed his name.
Balustrus?
Jubal scowled, an image of the crippled metal master flashing in his mind.
I know what you're thinking, the Lizarine injected hastily, but I have done much to perfect my skills since then. I was surprised, though, that he recommended me. At the time, he was not at all pleased with the results of my work.
I see. The slaver murmured.
He shot a look at Salaman, who nodded slightly, acknowledging that the metal master would have to be investigated more closely.
But if I follow your program, I will be able to use my legs, normally.
Oh, yes, Furtan assured him confidently. The key factor is exercise. Balustrus remained abed throughout the process, so his joints fused together. If you have the strength and will to work your legs constantly, you should regain full mobility.
Do that for me, and I'll pay you double your fee, however large, without question or complaint. When can you begin?
As soon as your man there takes his leave of our company, the sorcerer said.
What?
Salaman exclaimed, rising to his feet.
You said nothing about...
I'm saying it now, Vertan cut him short. Our methods are generally known, but our techniques are guarded. If one undisciplined in our order were to learn them and then attempt to duplicate our efforts without complete understanding of the signs and dangers, the results would be not only disastrous, but demeaning to our humble order. None but the patient may witness what I propose to do. The laws of our order are most strict about this.
Let it pass, Salaman, Jubal ordered. I had other plans for you. I get no pleasure or support from having others see me in this weakened condition. Even you. If I am to rebuild my force, I will need two things. My normal physical health intact, and current information of happenings in Sanctuary. The healing is my task, one you cannot help me with. But for the information, I must rely on you, as I have so many times in the past.
He turned to the Lizarine.
How long will your healing take?
The healer shrugged.
The time is not exact. Perhaps 2 months?
Jubal spoke again to Salaman.
Return to town and don't come back for 3 months. You have access to most of our hidden funds. Use them and live well.
Anyone hunting hawk masks will not think to look among the wealthy.
That hunting should serve as a weeding to test the fitness of our remaining swords. Learn their whereabouts and watch them, but let none know I'm still alive. After 3 months, we'll meet and decide who is to be included in the new organization.
If you are as wealthy as your words,
Vertan interjected cautiously,
might I make an additional suggestion?
Jubal cocked an eyebrow, but indicated the wizard should continue.
There are several wizards in Sanctuary who have the power to ferret out your location. If I were to provide a list of their names and estimates of their bribe price, you could ensure your safety during the healing process by paying them not to find you.
Salaman snorted.
That way they'll take our money and still sell their services to the first hunter that asks. How trustworthy do you really think your colleagues are, healer?
No more or less trustworthy than a sellsword, the Lizarine countered. Every person has weaknesses, though some are weaker than others. While a few might be unscrupulous enough to accept double service, at least you can eliminate the danger from the honest practitioners.
See that it's done,
Jubal instructed Salaman.
There are two other things I want when you return. Find Hakim and let him accompany you to witness my recovery.
The storyteller? Why?
He has amused us with his tales in the past,
Jubal smiled,
as well as providing occasional bits of timely information. Sharing this story with him will guarantee that all will hear of my return to power.
Salaman frowned but did not protest further.
What else?
A sword,
Jubal stated, his eyes suddenly fierce.
The finest sword you can find. Not the prettiest, mind you. The best steel, with the keenest edge. There will be some who will be less than happy at the news of my recovery, and I want to be prepared to deal with them.
That's enough for today,
Vertan announced shakily, removing his hands from Jubal's knees. Like a drowning man encountering a log, the healer grabbed the goat tethered nearby and clung to it while the animal bleated and struggled to free itself. The slaver averted his eyes, nauseated by the now familiar ritual. The first day he had watched intently, and what he had seen was now branded into his memory. Though he had always loathed magic and its practitioners, he now admitted a grudging admiration of the little wizard who labored over him. He would rather face 100 swords than subject himself to what the Lizarine endured voluntarily. Vertan drew the poison from Jubal's legs, as promised, but what the ex-gladiator had not realized was that the wizard drew it into his own body. He had seen Vertan's hands after the first session, swollen and misshapen, dripping pus from deep, cracked skin, caricatures of hands in the flickering candlelight. The poison was then transferred to one of the goats, whose body would then undertake to heal the invading infection. Over a dozen of the herd now had swellings or sores from taking part in the treatments. Jubal was astounded, frightened by the volume of poison in his ravaged legs, while several animals now coped with his infection, thereby lessening its power. It had all passed through Vertan. Rather than being annoyed with the little wizard's frequent recuperative rests, Jubal was amazed at the Lizarine's tenacity.
A few more days will complete this phase of the treatment, Vertan said weakly, releasing the goat. Then the real trial begins.
Jubal gagged at the smell wafting from Vertan's kettle. He had known odors before which others found revolting, the rotting smell of blood and entrails, which the wind carried from the charnel house to his estate, the stink of unwashed bodies, alive or dead, the clinging aroma of the excretions of penned animals, the acrid bite of the stench of the swamp at low tide. All these he had suffered without comment or complaint. But this, whatever bubbled in Vertan's pot, was an abomination. No such odor had ever been generated by nature or civilization. Of that Jubal was certain.
Drink,
Vertan ordered, thrusting a ladle into the slaver's hands.
Two swallows, no more.
The contents of the ladle were still bubbling. They had the appearance and texture of vomit. But Jubal drank. The first swallow was surprisingly cool on his tongue, but the second had the warmth and pulse of something alive.
Jubal took it down with the same detached resolve he had used to kill his first helpless crippled opponent, and handed the ladle back to the wizard.
With a satisfied nod, the Lizarine tossed the utensil back into the kettle, and then extended his hands, palms down, until they were each a few inches above Jubal's knees.
Brace yourself, swordsman, he ordered. You're about to begin learning about pain.
Something moved under the skin of the slaver's right knee, sending a quick stab of agony along his leg. Another piece moved, grating against the first. Then the movement began in his left knee. Despite his resolve, an animal howl of pain escaped Jubal's lips, a wordless note that rose and sank as the pieces of his shattered kneecaps shifted and realigned themselves. The world had faded from knowledge when Vertan's voice came to him through the red mists.
Now move your legs. Move them. You must flex your knees.
With a giant effort, Jubal bent his right knee, sliding his foot along the dirt floor. The pain was beyond sound now, though his mouth strained with silent screams.
More! You must bend it completely! More, swordsman! Do you want to be a cripple? More! The other knee! More! Move it!
Spittle ran down from the corner of the slaver's mouth. He soiled himself from the agony, but he kept moving, bending first one knee, then the other. Right knee, straighten. Left knee, straighten. Right knee. He was disoriented in time and space. His entire world had been reduced to the effort of repeating the simple exercise.
Where's that will you bragged about? The torturer taunted.
More! Bend those knees completely! Move!
He was growing used to the taste of Vertan's vile potion. It still disgusted him, but the repeated doses had made the nausea familiar and therefore acceptable.
Today you stand,
the wizard announced, without fanfare. Jubal hesitated, a piece of roast goat meat halfway to his lips. As promised, he was now eating 5 meals for every one the Lizarine ate.
Am I ready?
No,
Vertan admitted. But there's more involved here than your knees.
Your muscles, especially your leg muscles, must be worked if you are to keep any strength in them. Waving your feet in the air isn't enough for your legs. They must bear weight again, and the sooner the better.
Very well,
the slaver agreed, finishing the last of the meat and wiping his hands on his sleeves.
Let's do it now, before I've got to relieve myself again.
That function, too, had increased fivefold. Seizing the wall with one hand, Jubal drew his feet under him, then pushed with his legs. Standing up had once seemed so simple, nothing he ever thought about. Now, Sweat popped out of his brow, and his vision blurred. He kept pushing, but now agony was as familiar as the Lizarine's face. Slowly, his hands scrabbling against the walls, he rose until his weight was on his feet.
"There,"
he stated through clenched teeth, wishing he could stop the waving motion of the floor and walls around him.
"As you said, nothing is impossible if the will is strong enough."
"Good," Vertan said with a malicious laugh.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.